Hello, Anaheim. All right. So my name is Albert Caballero, and I am the field CISO for SentinelOne. We'll briefly be going over some causes and impacts on cloud incidents. We'll also talk about our Watchtower, Vigilance, and Sentinel Labs research services. And we'll take you on a play-by-play of real-life ransomware on a commercial application. We'll also see a short video of how our platform does protect and stop ransomware in its tracks. So this is the lightning theater, so I'm going to plow through this very quickly. I know you guys are probably tired of hearing these causes. However, misconfigured resources, S3 buckets publicly accessible, but that has also extended into Elasticsearch, OpenSearch databases. We've seen just last year 1,200 Elasticsearch databases on the internet publicly ransomed. So this is something that is ongoing and definitely something we need to address. Compromised credentials, we know that they're hard-coded in repos, public and private. We know that keys aren't rotated very often, so it's quite easy for an attacker to come across these types of credentials, leverage that, and attack your cloud infrastructure. Vulnerable applications. We know that both commercial and open source applications are vulnerable all the time. Vulnerabilities are pronounced or announced on a daily basis. We'll take you on a play-by-play of a commercial application that just got recently ransomed. But also Log4j, for example, open source, you know, who can forget that Christmas season a year and a half ago, right? It created a lot of problems for a lot of people. Lack of tooling, on-premise pivot, supply chain issues, that goes on and on, right? So to not beleaguer that point, we're going to talk a little bit about what is the impact, right? So resource theft. Crypto mining is something that's happening all the time on a daily basis. Just last year, we also saw a crypto mining malware that went ahead and fired up a bunch of lambdas, ran some bash scripts, and actually leveraged a customer's environment to mine Bitcoin. It cost the customer about $45,000 in AWS cost, and the attacker walked away with like $800 in Monero Bitcoin. So obviously they have no regard for what it is it's costing you, as long as they get a little bit of money in their pocket, right? Double extortion. It used to be the day that people would encrypt all of your files on your hard drive, keep the key, ransom the key back to you, and you decrypted it. Great. Now they encrypt all of your data, they exfiltrate your data, they ransom the key back to you so you can decrypt it, and then later on they ransom you again so that they don't leak the data that they acquired from you. So it's a double extortion type of scenario that happens on a daily basis. Data theft, we saw just last year an AWS employee actually got convicted for their role in the Capital One breach, right? They used their internal knowledge of vulnerable databases in the cloud to not only breach Capital One's environment, but 30 other organizations walked away with 100 million records worth of social security numbers, date of births, usernames, and all of that. This is happening constantly. We've seen a 35% year-over-year increase in denial of service attacks, and customer breaches happen all the time. They take over your cloud environment and launch attacks against the general public and also against your own customers. SentinelOne sees a ton of Mirai and Mozi botnet activity in all of our customer cloud environments. So that being said, causes and impacts, what are we doing about it, right? So SentinelOne, as an organization, has a service, a managed threat service called Watchtower. We have researchers, reverse engineers, and threat intelligence experts on a constant basis tracking these malware families over the internet, tracking over 50 ransomware groups, and over the last 12 months, we've actually investigated over 808.5 million atomic and behavioral IOCs across the internet. So this is happening on a daily basis, and we do publish these on our website. We have a managed detection and remediation service that we layer on top of SentinelOne. That's called Vigilance, right? So here's an outlook of a customer, one customer, over the last 12 months. This customer actually generated over 1.1 million storylines. A storyline is basically just a compilation of events, network connections, file modifications, registry entries that we put together in a storyline that lines out what it is that the attack is happening. Of those 1.1 million storylines, 21,000 of them turned out to be suspicious. We've auto-remediated 15,000 of them. Our managed detection and response system actually investigated and triaged over 6,000 of those, ultimately only escalating 32 events to the customer's SOC, obviously saving a whole lot of time and money. So now here's the good part. What do we do with all of this research, right? So Watchtower has an external outlook. They're looking on the internet, tracking ransomware groups, malware families, all of that. Vigilance actually internally working on our platform to investigate, analyze, and triage these events. Sentinel Labs actually publishes these studies, right? So we just recently published a 30 or 40 page document on dissecting AlienFox. AlienFox, like many other malware families over there, what they do is they scan the internet. They scan the internet to harvest these credentials from your cloud environment. They, in the latest version, actually establish persistence in an AWS account, and then they leverage that persistence for spam campaigns. So this is something that happens, again, on a daily basis. Doki is quite interesting, and probably why we're here today is because it is targeting Linux and Docker implementations, right? So it compromises with a curl command, one of your Docker containers, to avoid the persistence or to add persistence to the situation. They can use the Docker create API to run their own Docker container and then bind the file system of the Docker container to the root file system of the underlying operating system. From there, they can run arbitrary code on the underlying file system. So it's no longer that malware actually targets Windows, but it's actually been moving towards the Linux, Docker, Kubernetes, and container environment more and more. We'll actually take you on a video that shows dark radiation as it's happening and as SentinelOne is blocking it, so I won't spend too much time on that. And Icefire ransomware is something we're actually going to talk about right now. We're going to take you on a play-by-play of the threat spotlight and give you a threat spotlight on Icefire. So here's the basic setup. There's a Linux file server exposed to the internet. By design, we transfer files from customers, partners, and vendors alike on a daily basis over the internet. That's in itself inherently not a problem. But the problem comes when you have a vulnerability on the commercial application that's running or open source application that's running in your Docker container or in your Linux EC2 instance, right? So we saw the IBM FastPax protocol get release a vulnerability not too long ago. That allows an attacker to actually compromise a Linux server exposed on the internet. The trick here, or what is interesting, is that this is a pre-authentication remote code execution vulnerability. So when you have the combination of a publicly exposed Linux server with a pre-authentication RCE available to you, it's a recipe for disaster, right? It's a situation that you have to patch immediately or you have to have protection software running on the system itself to be able to prevent this in real time. So what does the attacker do? He exploits the CVE and obviously creates a reverse shell back to his attack infrastructure, right? From that remote shell, then comes the actual attack, right? First, they go ahead and remove any files from the underlying directories. Of course, not to step on their own toes or anyone else's toes that might be attacking the system at the same time. Then they download two files. They run a wget to download demo, and they run a wget to download the iFire file. They go ahead and change the permissions on the demo file, and they execute it to start encrypting the hard drive. This is happening on a daily basis, and it's happening with all types of different malware across the cloud and the internet. Here you see how we detect it. We can actually give an entire process storyline about what happened, and we give you the command lines that were executed on the system in that remote terminal. Okay. Now what we'll do is we're going to show a little video of how dark remediation actually compromises the system, but there's SentinelOne installed on this one. So we should be able to get a good idea of how quickly we can stop this type of attack at machine speed. So there's the SentinelOne agent. The agent is in our console, and there's an SSH session open to a Linux AMI, or EC2, I should say. In the agent now, within our console, you can actually configure dynamic groups and policies based on your AWS metadata. So if you want everything in a particular VPC to join a particular group within our console and apply a custom policy to that group, then you can do so. In this case, the policy will be set to protect and to detect on non-malicious or suspicious activity, right? So we're SSHing into the Linux box, and we download and run the ransomware attack. In less than a second, the SSH session is severed. From here, we can go to the incidents and we can take a look what happened. Now, we see that a threat was successfully mitigated on this particular server, right? We can then further infer that it was blocked by behavioral AI engine. And what that means is that no signature is required. Regular antiviruses that are based on signatures cannot block this type of attack. And furthermore, we got the entire, again, CLI command, including the passphrase that was used to encrypt the underlying files. So you can potentially use that to decrypt the files if it gets encrypted on some other system that potentially maybe didn't have SentinelOne. Here you can go into all of the processes that occurred during that transaction, and you can make sure that you know exactly what happened on your system from the terminal session and when it was blocked. Again, including the passphrase to decrypt the ransom files. Of course, dark radiation did not work and was not successful because SentinelOne is implemented on this particular box. So what's the architecture with our Singularity Cloud, right? We have all of the agents. All of the agents are reporting their EDR telemetry, or endpoint detection and response telemetry, into our security data lake. Now, our security data lake allows you to ingest data from all sorts of platforms. It could be identity data, firewall logs, you name it. So whatever's too expensive to put in your SIM, you might want to put it in a data lake, ours or any other data lake, right? So once you have all of your information in the data lake, we have all of these functionality that we layer on top of that, right? The storyline functionality that we saw with the processes and the command line scripts. We also have one-click auto remediation, remote ops, data collection. You can collect forensic data off of your agents after a situation that you may be investigating. STAR rules are extremely powerful because it allows you to basically do anything on the remote operating system, bring your own script, do whatever you need to do to remediate as you go along. And then we also layer the watchtower and vigilance services on top. So again, we go ahead and not only research threats on the internet at scale, at machine speed, but we also do our own triage and we inform all of our behavioral engines that way. We have multiple detection engines, static AI engine, behavioral AI engine. So all of this information gets processed and you can gain insights from it. Now, on the right, you see connect, right? So you can connect to our security data lake from any platform out there. If you're using Splunk, if you use Slack for your incident response, whatever it is that you're using, there's a powerful API that you can use. And if you have a situation, many people just send our alerts, like, to their Splunk SIM. Well, that's not a problem. You send our alerts to the Splunk SIM, that alerts you, and you want to get EDR telemetry data out of our security data lake, which is just way too expensive to send to your SIM, you can do that right from Splunk, right? So this is not a replacement for your SIM. It's supposed to augment your SIM. And of course, we have multi-cloud and hybrid solutions for all workloads. We support Kubernetes, EKS, Docker, pretty much any container that you have running in the cloud. So the key takeaways here is that you do need real-time detection at machine speed to prevent attacks, even in your containers, even in your Kubernetes environment. It's not just for the server and the workstation, right? We do hunting and forensics at petabyte scale. We do it across the internet to track malware families and ransomware groups, and we also do it within our own data lake and our own customer environments. And you do need machine speed, AI-powered, eBPF type of remediation so that you can keep up with the attackers nowadays, right? With that, I'll let you get to your happy hour. I appreciate your time. My name's Albert Caballero, and I'm the field CISO at SentinelOne. Please visit our booth. We're right across the way, right next to the other vendors that will remain unnamed. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.